Hey everyone, I have a great interview for you all today. I'm joined now by Jen Perlman. She is running in the Democratic primary for Florida's 23rd Congressional District against Debbie Wasserman Schultz. Jen, welcome back to the show.
Thank you so much for having me on again.
So it's been, at least a few months now since I had you on. There's been a lot happening in the world. So I want to talk about, we'll get to COVID-19, we'll get to Biden versus Trump. But first, I want to start off with just getting your thoughts on the protests going on around the country in reaction to what happened to George Floyd, and also what you think, Congress should be doing right now in relation to criminal justice.
I actually am of the mindset that I'm amazed that this doesn't happen more and hasn't happened sooner. I have been saying for a very long time that while I am not a proponent of violence, power concedes nothing. And historically speaking, it's an unfortunate escalation that is going to occur from people who can only take so much oppression. So while I do not condone violence, I completely understand it. And, you know, this is, and it's also, we're seeing obviously that a lot of the violence is not coming from the protesters, right? A lot of the violence is being sort of planted and, you know, just creating this incendiary environment so that they can sort of justify more violence. So, you know, this to me was inevitable. It's inevitable. If I were in a disenfranchised and vulnerable community that has repeatedly for hundreds of years been basically systematically oppressed, I'm pretty sure that I would have started something a long time ago. So, you know, it's, to me, I see both sides of it very, very clearly.
Yeah, and as you said, we've seen these sorts of protests go on before. This time it feels almost a little different in the sense where I feel like a lot more people are kind of catching on to what's going on, especially you're seeing all the videos now come out with police instigating violence on camera. I mean, they're well aware they're being filmed, and they're still instigating and escalating this violence. And essentially, there's no hiding anymore. Everyone knows what these police forces are doing. So what are your thoughts on demilitarizing the police and also defunding the police to deal with this, with how they treat the Black community?
100%. My platform specifically calls for the demilitarization of the police departments, among other sorts of things that would lead to more accountability and more transparency. We need civilian oversight. We need police departments to be accountable for their own money and such that if you're going to be sued for civil rights violations, that's going to come out of your budget and your pension. And when we start seeing those types of policies, I think that we'll start seeing police departments rein in their own. Because when they know that this is ultimately going to affect their bottom line, they'll police themselves. I have no doubt that if the money for paying these civil rights violations didn't come out of taxpayer dollars, but actually came out of the police department's budget, they wouldn't be tolerating these types of officers for as long as they have. So, there are certain things that have to be dealt with via policy, things like defunding, demilitarizing. But, you know, a lot of it is really just, to me, the kind of people and the kind of mentality that go into law enforcement right now. This isn't the same as maybe 50 years ago, someone who wanted to protect and serve. And there are those police officers, let me be very clear. There are absolutely police officers that do want to protect and serve. The problem is they are working within a system that is perpetually disenfranchising and discriminating and racist. So even well-intended and well-meaning officers are still functioning within a system that was designed, by the way, police officers were designed originally as slave patrols. Our entire law enforcement was essentially built on the backs of slave patrols. And so it's not enough to just say we're not going to give you money. It really needs to go towards the psychology of people that are wanting to be police officers, and especially people that want to participate in policing, given how militarized our police departments are. That is clearly speaking to a certain mentality of people that want to get geared up and ready for battle. And so there are many different angles that have to be used in dealing with this, but nothing will happen so long as we do not acknowledge the systemic rot. And it's not just in policing, it's everywhere. But just we see it the most, I think, brutally, obviously, with policing. But we have to not only acknowledge it, but we have to elect people that aren't on the payrolls that keep it the way it is.
Yeah, absolutely. And you also just see I guess the general approach to funding when it comes to you're seeing these inflated police budgets. Meanwhile, there's cuts to healthcare, cuts to education, cuts to infrastructure, cuts to social spending. I mean, what are your thoughts on, I guess, the complete failure really of leadership in both the Republican Party and Democratic Party? What are your thoughts on essentially them being unable or having been unable to deal with this situation, even while under a Democratic president for 8 years under Barack Obama?
I would argue that it's not a failure. I would argue that it's very specifically designed this way. We're not talking about a group of people that are sitting and milling around and can't quite figure out how to solve the problem. If we were dealing with a group of people that were well-intended and sincere and were really trying to figure out how to solve it and they just couldn't do it, that would be a failure of our system. What we're seeing is legalized bribery and corruption at such a gargantuan level that we don't even know what we're supposed to expect from representatives anymore. And this has nothing to do with Democrats and Republicans and the fake blue-red color war that we're being sold as if we actually have a choice. We have one party, and that's the corporate party. So, I get that some people are very interested in third parties, and I would say, how about a second? How about a labor party? We have no labor party in this country right now. So you can put a D next to your name and you can paint your signs blue. But if you're not representing labor and you're not standing up for working class people, you are not the labor party. So what we have are two corporate parties in different colors. And no, they are not trying to fix this because they are too busy reaping the benefits financially from all of the organizations and interests that perpetuate this. So I would argue that the first step is to get the money out in the legalized bribery. And that's no small feat, by the way. That's pretty monumental. And then once you do that, then we can start to have a reasonable discussion on how to fix these things. Those people have no interest in fixing this. I refuse to accept that these are not things that can be fixed. That's just ludicrous. We see numerous other countries that somehow have managed to better navigate this method, this system. It's not a failure in being able to figure it out. It's a failure in courage to do something and to speak up against the powerful corporate American interests that are taking over.